Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Ham Nation is provided by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by NatureBox. NatureBox ships great-tasting snacks right to your door. Start snacking smarter with wholesome, delicious treats like strawberry Greek yogurt pretzels. To get your complimentary NatureBox sampler, visit naturebox.com/twit. That's naturebox.com/twit. And by Harry's. For guys who want a great shave experience for a fraction of what you're paying now, go to harrys.com. Get $5 off your first purchase by entering the code HAMNATION when you check out. And by ICOM. For more information, visit icomamerica.com/hamnation. This is Ham Nation, episode number 183 for February 11th, 2015. Dr. D-Star is in. Hey, good evening, everybody. It's Wednesday night at 8 o'clock Central. Probably a different time, depending on where you are. But nonetheless, all over the planet, it's Ham Nation time. Hello, it's Mardi Gras time here in the New Orleans area. So I'm wearing my Mardi Gras shirt and my beads and everything, and the parade's all start in earnest tonight to culminate next Tuesday night for Mardi Gras. So next Wednesday, there's no telling what shape I'll be in, but I'll be in a shape. It'll probably be round, but I'll be in a shape. Let's go around the horn and see who we've got tonight. We have a couple of hours up to my north. We have George Thomas, W5JDX up in Jackson. How are you tonight, sir?
I am doing fine, Don. And for my shirt tonight, I am wearing a broadcast Radio Shack shirt, and the Radio Shack sign behind me is flying half-mast this week.
Yeah, that is sad news about Radio Shack. We've got details on that coming up in Amateur Radio News on a little bit later on down the show. But let's head out west where the beautiful people are, and there's Gordon West, WB6NOY. How you doing tonight, sir?
I am fine. And it is sad about Radio Shack. You know, they were one of the very first large organizations to take on the Gordo training books. But this weekend, big celebration, a little bit beyond where you are, Don, in Orlando. It's the Hamcation. That's a biggie for Orlando ham radio operators. Put your jackets on, though, because I understand it's going to be cold, but hopefully it'll be nice and sunny. Also up in Milwaukee this weekend, this Saturday, the Radio Amateur Group and the Amateur Radio Society of Brookfield, Wisconsin, that's the Milwaukee group, is having their big get-together on Saturday, which is Valentine's Day. And also, by special announcement, the Portage Amateur Radio Service says they are having their annual Freeze Your, better do the censored sign, freeze your you-know-what off, and it's a QRP mini field day special event station on February 14th. So tune them in as they're freezing their acorns off, as they say. Thank you very much. And then a week from next is the big Yuma Amfest, and we'll tell you more about that a little later on, as well as next week. So lots of things happening out there this weekend. Remember, Valentine's Day. Don't forget your special Valentine. Back to you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Saturday is Valentine's Day. It's odd to have Valentine's Day and Mardi Gras right in the middle of each other. Mardi Gras is very early tonight. We also have a new face tonight that's going to be joining us, and that is Joe Mesh. Joe, how are you tonight?
Excellent. Good to see everybody. And Don, I love that green shirt you got on tonight.
Thank you, sir. We will be back to talk with you in just a little bit. But Gordo, why don't you go ahead and get us started on your short shots.
Okay. Short shots. And I noticed Joe has a little furry thing off of the radio, a little bit of fuzzball. So he'll have to show that off. Well, tonight we're going to talk about making it happen. Oh, there we go. Thanks, Joe. I needed a cat.
Oh,
it's a dog
cool.
bed.
It's a dog. This is real, the amateur radio dog right here.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, happy Valentine's Day to your pet. Anyway, we're going to talk about live as opposed to not live. And, you know, all of our sponsors, they give us live stuff to munch with. They give us live utensils to shave with. And that's what we're going to talk about. And that is the importance of going live with demos for your next club meeting, or similar to what we did at Quartz Fest, going live with our demos. So, Brian, there's our CW. That means the first shot. And one of the requirements we asked all of our presenters at Quartz Fest this past few weeks ago was make your presentation live, because there's no place for PowerPoint, no flip charts, but rather make it live. So Neil was one of the first to come out with power supplies that deliver 14 volts no matter what the voltage. And he had a variable supply there to voltage check it. And these power supplies are quite unique. You can get them at the local ham store this weekend at Orlando. And they are battery booster type of power supplies that always keep the voltage at 13.8. He proved it by going live with all the test meters to show. This is Don, N9ZGE. He talked about automatic antenna tuners, and he had them there live, tied into the ICOM 718. And we did radio checks, and he showed how all the tuners work, and you could hear the relays. You could see them on some of them. But he didn't just talk tuners. He showed them, and he demoed them live. So for your club meeting, if you're going to talk about antenna tuners, get them out of the box so folks can see exactly how they work live. Not PowerPoint, but actually live. Neil says when you talk dipoles, show them the dipole. This is a trap dipole. He's got it up and playing well. And again, it was live, and he turned it 90 degrees, and people could hear the effects of a dipole when the signals would fade out when they were no longer coming in broadside. Live testing. This is offering amateur radio examinations. You don't have to do them inside. You can do them outside. And it points out you can adapt. This one particular ham was not able to move off of his conveyance, so they gave him the test right there. That is going live and making things happen, saying that maybe it wouldn't work. Well, this is Bill, K6ACJ. He went live with a Arduino project. And as you can see, he's got it all breadboarded out, and it worked great, and it drew a lot of attention. You could talk about it, you could draw it, but nothing beats actually showing it live and in use. Live was D-Star, and that is N4SVD, the famous AC, and he had his repeater up. He walked around to make sure everybody knew that D-Star was active out at Quartz Fest, but he did it live. And that was great. That's Tracy and Marilyn and others. And they were showing off emergency preparedness. And while it's slightly out of the picture, you can see a lot of the gear, or imagine it, on that table. And they demonstrated it live. And let me tell you, talk about hams that make it happen. This gentleman comes every year to Quartz Fest in the wheelchair. He doesn't need a push. He doesn't need a pull. He makes it happen. And that's what we think is so great about a ham fest, where folks can just jump right in and make it happen. Bruce KT4 Echo Tango is going to be at the Yuma Ham Fest coming up. Live, he does classes and demonstrations on how to put call signs onto some neat little armbands. So pretty neat stuff. Thanks for showing us live. Live, we brought in wind about 30 miles an hour. And you could see the effects of these great wind generators with live discussion as to voltage regulation and so on. Live, not just on paper, cast iron cooking. And this one was not only see it live and direct, but to feel the heat and take the lid off with a gloved hand. And cast iron cooking, you can smell the results and even taste them as well. And thanks to Rick for putting that on W7RAP. But we did it live. We just didn't talk about it. Live on 10,000 megahertz. That's Gary, W6KBC. Mike was there also talking about amateur television. And we actually had live demos of 10,000 megahertz. One of the other San Bernardino Microwave Association members in the background, he was doing digital at 10,000. And there's a live look at real equipment. You got cold, you just put your hands in front of the horn. No, I'm just kidding. But anyway, live demonstrations. You could talk about it, but nothing beats actually getting up there and seeing it. Nothing beats getting right down there and working DX from your own little shack. We took a close look inside to see if all the gear was, oh, it is live. Look at that, little ICOM 706, maybe the 7000. He's got the keyer there, and there's a station on the air for everybody to take a look at and even do a little bit of operating as well. There's our headphones, and those came right off the shelf. The Heil headphones are demonstrated by Ward, K7PO, which was our lead W7Q special event station operator. And in the wind is really howling at about 25 miles an hour. There was no hint of wind noise on that. And there's our Tai Chi lady, W6G or W9W. Anyway, there's Heather, GEM. She's a gem of a lady, smiling, and she does Tai Chi in the morning. She loved the headset, and she came through the ICOM 9100 loud and clear. Look at that solar panel behind her. Now, this is our fearless leader for next year, K1 Alpha November, and Dan is the one that is organizing the get-together week after next in Yuma. He is the leadership of Quartz Fest 16. And he promises to maintain, we want it live. We want real live gear, not just talk. And there's Neil again, Captain Neil. He's got Nisa, his parrot. And he's talking about quadcopters. Oh, yeah, you could show it. You could hold it up the air, talk about the controller. But nothing beats a quadcopter when it is live and direct. And by the way, he was speaking live and direct off a little portable PA system. And we tried the Heil wireless mic that work on Bluetooth frequency. It worked flawlessly hundreds of feet away. And there's our little PA system. Oh, there's Russ and Debbie, our music team. And you'll be hearing more about them shortly. Great shot, Russ. Thanks again for all your music capability. Deb, thanks for keeping him live and direct for our Hoot Nanny. Of course, live movies at night, and as you can tell, we packed the crowd, and again, no electricity. Oh, there's Randy, looking good. Randy and team are going to be heading to Oshkosh in a few more months, but Randy was here live. Here we go, live and direct. Neil and Sean lit up their quadcopters, and over the campfire, people were not expecting them, and they didn't know what they were seeing when they saw these getting buzzed. But what a great demonstration. And, of course, live and direct to tour the Quartz Fest, there's AC and Cliff, and they're going around. And did they have a good time? Look at these two hams. Maybe not playing radio, but yes, indeed. Live from Quartz Fest, they were having a great time. So whether it was the Burning Man and dead handhelds, We tried to do as many action things as possible as ham operators. And, of course, Randy, in a few moments, will be showing some of the live shots. But I encourage all of you that if you're going to be presenting a seminar, don't just talk it. Make it live. Bring the gear. It's a pain in the butt to have to bring all the gear in, bring it out. But that's what we're going to do in Yuma for our Instructor Academy. So go live, not just PowerPoint. Make it live gear. Okay, back to our host.
Awesome stuff, Gordo. I got to make it out to Quartz Fest one of these times. It's just, I'm itching. Well, we are going to carry on and talk to Dr. Mesh here in just a little bit. But first, we want to bring in the first of our sponsors, and that is NatureBox. NatureBox is great to Ham Nation, and it's great for you. And right now, NatureBox is giving you a chance to get a complimentary trial box of their most popular snacks. You just pay $2 shipping. Heck of a deal. Life is hectic. It's hard to make the best snacking choices. If you're looking for a quick pick-me-up, what you need to do is get delicious, healthy snacks at naturebox.com. There's Gordo enjoying his NatureBox. It's good stuff. They have hundreds of delicious, nutritionist-approved snacks. And look, there's George, what are you eating? Which ones do you have there?
Honey macadamia pretzel pops. They're pretty good.
That sounds good. That's good. Gordon, what are you munching on over there?
I have sticks and stones will break my bones and
sriracha pops.
And they'll burn my mouth, I'm sure, but it's good.
Ah, the sriracha. Yeah, that's good stuff. Anyway, the choice is amazing. Hundreds and hundreds of delicious nutritionist approved snacks. I've got coffee kettle popcorn. And the only reason why this bag is not open is because, well, it's popcorn. And as soon as it's open, I'll just go through the whole thing. But anyway, it's all delicious and it's nutritionist approved. Zero artificial flavors, zero artificial colors, no artificial sweeteners, no grams of trans fat, no high fructose corn syrup, nothing but goodness. You'll even find snacks with bold flavors you crave, like those sriracha cashews that Gordon's going in there. So in the afternoon when you're hungry, do what I do. Grab the cinnamon spiced almonds, the sriracha pop pops, the cranberry pepita crisps. You know you're going to snack, so you may as well do it smart with Nature Box and grab your trial today and get your complimentary sampler box at naturebox.com/twit. Stay full, stay strong, start snacking smarter. Naturebox.com/twit. Thank you so much for your support of Ham Nation. Now, before we throw to George, I've got the peanut butter nom noms. And you may be asking, why do they call them peanut butter nom noms? Well, let me show you.
Oh, nom, 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 nom. Oh, my God. Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. George.
He's enjoying that just a little bit too much.
Oh, George. Nom, 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 nom.
Oh, is that my cue, Don?
Oh, yeah. I'll be here. I'll be over in the corner with my nom noms.
We've got a new friend on the show here tonight that is going to come in and talk a little bit about the digital mode. You know, there's beginning to be a number of them out there now. And, well, Dr. Joe Mesh is here with us. We're going to talk a little bit about it tonight. Joe, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, and it's a pleasure to be here, George. And I usually go by just Joe, but thank you very much. Go ahead, George.
Okay, so you've been, well, how long have you been a ham, actually, and when did you decide to start doing the digital modes?
Oh, I've been a ham a long time. I just, it's over 50 years. I hate to say that, but I really enjoy amateur radio. It's got a lifelong challenge. There's so many facets, and I've always enjoyed it. I started when I was 11. I think I got my license around 13. Way back then, you know, we did the one-year novice that was CW only. You remember all of that. As far as digital modes go, gee, I first started in D-Star when D-Star first came out. It's got to be, I don't know exactly, what is it, maybe 12 years now, I would say, in terms of D-Star. And I've been playing around with APCO 25 for a long time, as well as DMR.
Okay, so do you still operate HF, or have you mostly moved over to the digital realm now?
Yeah, no, I enjoy HF. In fact, I was on last night and worked K1N. Very unique circumstance, just happened to turn 20 on. Looked at the waterfall, 20 was absolutely dead. There wasn't a single signal on. I rotated the array down towards Navassa Island and just listened for a while. All of a sudden, I heard him calling CQ. Nobody was answering him. I gave him one quick call. He came right back to me. So that was really kind of a unique experience.
Yeah, I've been watching the social networks, and a lot of people are talking about on there, and I have not heard them yet. I tried last week and couldn't hear anything. I heard the pileups trying to get to them, though. But I don't know, just a really busy week here, and I haven't really had a chance to get behind the radio much. I'm going to try to do it, maybe even after the show this evening. But congratulations to all those who have got through so far. Joe, well, you brought a little video for us tonight. How about setting it up?
Well, I was talking with Bob, and Bob one day said, hey, how'd you like to do something on D-Star for us? And I said, well, I'll give it a try, and that's pretty much the setup. George, that's basically what we did. So we've got a bunch of them coming, but this first one, here it is tonight.
One of the most fun things we do in this hobby, one of the most fun things in amateur radio is assembling the equipment that then becomes your station. And Gordon West, WB6NOA, recommends, particularly for new amateur radio operators, to look at maybe buying a handheld. How do we do that, and what are the considerations?
Running over a new radio with a truck is one type of test, but not a good idea at all.
Here's another test that we never get to perform on radios. We all know what happens when these radios get wet. Not a good sight. But would an ICOM D-Star radio handle it? Looks like it works underwater.
I like to start with the catalogs, and DX Engineering is a fabulous catalog because DX Engineering is the only company I know of that makes an awful lot of their own things. So you see more when you shop with this catalog. And if we're going to look at portable radios, we see right off the bat that there's a list of portable radios here. And of course, everybody compares price. And price is critical for a lot of amateur radio decisions. But let's look at what else sticks right out. All of a sudden, when we look at these, one says D-Star. What's D-Star all about? Let's find out. D-Star is digital modulation. And digital modulation means more than just digital voice, but also digital data in D-Star. Now, the digital data in D-Star is at 128 kilobytes. And although in D-Star we call that high-speed data, it's really not very high-speed at 128 kilobytes. Now, the digital voice is the important part. And the digital voice is not like the old AX.25 packet radio that's still around today. So you can't really, like, get your TNC out and run D-Star. Whole different thing, completely different approach to data. But there are other data, vocal data or voice data approaches. There's D-Star, as we mentioned. Then there's DMR. And DMR is kind of the same thing as Moto Turbo. And in that design, there are two slots. In other words, two conversations can go on in slots simultaneously. And that's really the biggest advantage of that. The next type is DPMR. Not a whole lot of use of DPMR these days. It meant digital private mobile radio, and there really isn't much going on with that anymore. P25 is the old APCO 25 that was designed by the Association of Chiefs of Police. P25's had a lot of commercial support. Motorola's done an awful lot of development, but it is an open format, and you know, GE and other people make equipment, Johnson. P25 is in amateur use. There is some out there, but there aren't a whole lot of repeaters. And then we have Yaesu Fusion. Yaesu Fusion is very unclear as to what it actually can accomplish and what it does. There's a large system working in Tokyo. Right now it doesn't appear to be on the internet yet, but slow but sure. The best way to approach Yaesu Fusion is to say we don't really know what it can accomplish. Although we've read a lot about it, we haven't really seen it do it yet. So, looking at that, D-Star, DMR, DPMR, P25, and Fusion, if you take all of them minus D-Star and add them up, and then compare that to D-Star, you have the availability of roughly less than a tenth of the D-Star repeaters. So there's very, very few repeaters available to you to pursue any of those others. And very few commercial radios available. By commercial, I mean amateur radio-ready commercial uses. Yes, you can buy a Motorola radio for P25, and you can buy the rib box and the cables, and you can get the software, and you can program it for amateur frequencies. But you got to be able to do that. Now, we said there are certain major advantages to D-Star. What are those advantages? The first one, unquestionably, is spectrum utilization. The D-Star signal is far smaller in width than conventional FM. That's a major advantage because it means we can allocate more channels. We can close down the separation between allocations, which means more repeaters and more pairs available. On VHF where I live, that would be huge. You really need more pairs. Very hard to get a coordination in Michigan. Next, we ID on every transmission. Every time you ker-chunk and press the push to talk, your call sign goes out. So that is automatically ID'd. And in fact, in checking into groups occasionally, they'll say just ker-chunk to check in and copy the calls. Next, call sign routing. So a big advantage of D-Star is that the way the network is fabricated, you can tell the network where to take your signal. So you can route to a zone, which means route to a specific repeater, or route to an individual, or route to everybody. It's up to you in terms of how you set up the radio. We also have crossband that's extremely easy. And when we do talk about programming the radio, we'll show you how easy it is to do crossband contacts with D-Star. And there's interleaved text data. And by that, I mean there's a 20-character long ASCII area where you can put in whatever you want to put in. And people put in all kinds of things. Some people put in the radio they're using. Other people put in where they're from. I put my internet address in there for email because people pick it up and use it and send you emails after contacts very frequently. And if there's one more advantage, and that's there's a Motorola white paper out there right now that shows that digital modulated signals, because they're narrower, actually have greater range. Now, it's up to you. You can read the paper and make your own decision. It's pretty well supported. There's one last really cool advantage, and that's GPS data that's also a part of the transmission. So if you wish to allow it, your GPS location goes out with every click of the push to talk. And that's really cool using a function called DPRS, very similar to APRS, that allows you to go to the Finnish website and track everything you've done or one of your buddies. And we'll look at that too. So in summary, with every press of the push to talk, we have digital voice data, we have the user data, or the caller ID. We have the routing as control data. And then we have the GPS data. A lot goes on in D-Star on the digital voice side.
Well, thanks, Joe. That really cleared up a lot there, because there are a lot of modes out there now. But you verified what I was thinking already. D-Star is pretty much... Well, I'll say for now anyway, has got the market sewed up. The others are really haven't taken off, or either they're just getting started.
Things change over the years, but right now, if you're going to spend money on a radio that does digital modulation, I think the choice is pretty clear. D-Star is the one that will allow you to have the most fun with your radio and the one that allows you to do more than just one or two things.
And that is correct. And it's not just an ICOM thing. You can get a lot of different D-Star radios, or maybe not radios, but modems and such around. As a matter of fact, I've just been working on one this week myself. It's the Northwest Digital Radio DV3000 module for the Raspberry Pi, and I'm going to be showing that Friday night on Amateur Logic. It's Mike, VE3MIC, and myself have been working on these for the past couple of weeks and got them up and running now. And boy, it's really a lot of fun.
Sure is. And that is an awfully nice board. Northwest has been offering that now for maybe about a month or so and haven't heard many on the air yet. I wonder if you did that with the new Raspberry Pi 2.
No, this was the original Raspberry Pi, you know, the slow one with only 256 megs of memory in it, and it runs just fine on that, so it should work with any of them. My Raspberry Pi 2 is supposedly in the mail now, but I won't be here for a few days yet.
Well, I understand. I really haven't heard very many. I've heard about them, but I haven't heard any on the air yet. The beauty of that AMBI 3000 chip is, of course, it'll do more than just D-Star. It really does pretty much all of the digital modes.
And that is correct. And I'm looking forward to trying some of the others as well. Right now, I haven't found any software for anything but D-Star, because Northwest Digital Radio doesn't really write the software themselves. They rely on third parties to release it. And you know, that's what I'm running right now. And there's nothing stopping anybody from writing software to run some of the other modes on it as well. And I'll be checking into the D-Star Net tonight after the show if you want to listen to it, Joe. It'll be on Reflector 14 Module C, and we'll let you see what it sounds like.
Wow, that'd be great. We'll look forward to hearing you on there. I do check in on 14, Charlie, pretty frequently, whenever I can anyhow. There's a little space between my work location and the repeater, and it's about 50 miles. So I can usually hear it a little before I can get into it.
Yeah, okay. Well, we appreciate you being here tonight, and we look forward to you bringing us some more great videos in the future there. Any final words before we go?
No, it's been a pleasure, George. Nice to see everyone, and we will see you next week, I believe. And next week, we're going to look a little more at DPRS and kind of a unique and interesting way to use it.
Well, that's great, and appreciate it once again, and we'll be looking for you then. Well, Don, what's going on in the news this week?
All kinds of stuff. Fascinating stuff, Joe. Appreciate you being here tonight. Now, all kinds of good stuff. K1N, of course, and some other stuff. And why, let's just find out now. From Amateur Radio Newsline Report, number 1951, these are the Ham Nation headlines for Wednesday, February 11th, 2015. K1N is on the air.
Thank you. This is Kilo 1 November. Kilo 1 November, South America. Central and South America.
Thank you. 73. This is Kilo 1 November. Kilo 1 November.
The first contingent of the K1N team fired up on 40 and 80 meter CW sometime around 0100 UTC Super Bowl Sunday, with stations stretching 10 to 20 kilohertz or more up the band from K1N's transmit frequency. By early Monday, February 2nd, hams are reporting via Facebook contacts on other bands, including 20 and 17 meters SSB.
73, Kilo 1 November, up 5.
Alpha Echo 5, Delta Whiskey.
Alpha Echo 5.
Alpha Echo 5, Delta Whiskey, 5-9.
Alpha Echo 5, Delta Whiskey, 5-9, thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Oh.
Yep, I'm in the log. Oh, by the way, a reminder, stations trying to work K1N should not transmit on the D-Expedition's frequency. Operations will always be on split. And you'll find late updates to K1N posted to their website, www.navassadx.com, and to the Amateur Radio Newsline page on Facebook. The Raspberry Pi Foundation has revealed the official second edition of its Raspberry Pi system on a chip computer.
This latest version, announced on February 2nd, promises speed increases of up to 6 times and compatibility with upcoming ARM builds of Windows 10. The Raspberry Pi 2 Model B consists of a quad-core ARM V7 Broadcom BCM2836 processor running at 900 MHz. It's supported by 1 GB of RAM, 4 USB 2.0 ports, a full-size HDMI out visual display port, micro USB power source, and micro SD port for storing data and loading an operating system. Since the Raspberry Pi system on a chip was introduced, it has become a mainstay around which many ham radio projects have been designed and built. For the Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Heather Emby, KB3TZD in Berwick, Pennsylvania.
The cost for the new Raspberry Pi 2 was announced at about $35 US. There are newly updated band plans in Europe.
The Radio Society of Great Britain has published the updated HF, VHF, UHF, and microwave band plans on its website. Included in the changes is clarification that VHF WSPR frequencies in the band plans are transmitted center frequencies and not dial settings. The new amateur satellite allocation at 144.0 to 144.025 MHz and the new United Kingdom 146 MHz and 2300 MHz bands are also detailed.
And finally this week, get ready to say goodbye to an old friend. Radio Shack Corporation has announced that it has filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection in a deal to shut down the almost century-old retail chain, one that would also sell about half its store leases to telecommunications giant Sprint and close the rest. In a press release dated Thursday, March 5th, the company announced that it had signed an asset purchase agreement with General Wireless, Inc. to acquire between 1,500 and 2,400 of Radio Shack's U.S. company-owned stores. The sale agreement is subject to court approval and other conditions. Radio Shack's foreign subsidiaries and its franchisee-owned stores are not included in the filing. As part of this action, Radio Shack has filed a motion with the court to proceed with the closure of the remaining company-owned stores under an agreement with Hilco Merchant Resources. Stores that are closing are expected to sell remaining inventory. Discussions are underway with interested parties to sell all of the company's remaining assets. You can find and download the list of store closures with a quick Google search of Radio Shack closures. And that's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline, your independent source for amateur radio news for over 37 years and counting at www.arnewsline.org. For Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF, Skeeter Nash, N5ASH, and Heather MB, KB3TZD, I'm Don Wilbanks, AE5DW, 73, and we'll see you next time here on Ham Nation. But now, let's turn to the solar forecast and Dr. Tamitha Scove.
Hi, I'm Tamitha Scove with your solar storm forecast for the week of June 11th. The sun has been incredibly busy this week, starting with this gorgeous filament eruption that occurred on June 4th. Now, this thing was 40 Earth lengths long by the time it erupted, and it did cause a geomagnetic storm at Earth, but more on that in a minute. First, I want to tell you about the new developments from region 2087, which was actively flaring before it even became visible on the Earth disk. And in the last 48 hours, it's given us three X-class flares and an M-class flare. Here's the X2.2 right here, followed by an M or an X1.5, and that has spawned a solar storm that might be partially Earth-directed. So looking at your solar storm conditions over the end of this week, you see at high latitudes the possibility is quite high, with a peak on June 13th. That's when we expect to get that glancing blow from the solar storm associated with that M1.5 flare. We expect to have active conditions with a 50% chance of a major storm at high latitudes and a 20% chance of a minor storm at mid-latitudes, and then unsettled conditions then as the storm begins to taper off. Now, turning to your solar flare and particle radiation storm outlook, NOAA has actually upped the X-class flare risk to 30% chance over the next 3 days. And the main player, of course, is region 2087. Now, because of that, we actually have a radiation storm watch in effect. We have a 30% chance of a particle storm. As this region continues to rotate onto the disk, it will continue to increase because we actually have more chance of radiation storms as these regions rotate to the west limb. So this week looks to be very exciting. We've got that solar storm glancing blow on the 13th, as well as X-flares that could happen at any time. And along with those X-flares means we could have a possible radiation storm in our future. Now, all of these disruptions mean you're probably going to have issues with your GPS or GPS-based traffic services, and you ham radio operators expect blackouts with those X-flares and also issues with satellite-based communication during the X-flares. But outside of that, enjoy your week and keep watching the sun. I'm Tamitha Scove. Thank you for watching.
Good stuff from Dr. Scove. Be sure and follow her on Twitter, at Tamitha Scove, and also you can see her full report. That's an edited version. Usually she goes 4 or 5 minutes. That's just a two-minute edit that I did tonight on spaceweather.tv. She's also on YouTube, but spaceweather.tv is a new website that she's got going, and it's being managed by a ham, so she's very aware. She watches the show. She's aware of what we're doing. And in fact, she may even be in the chat room tonight. I know I'd invited her to come and sit in with us. So Dr. T, if you're in the chat room, thanks for being here. But anyway, so thank you to Dr. Scove. Now, let's talk about saving money, not just with your ham radio stuff, but overpriced razors. This is a problem. And there's a company that's doing something about it. It's called Harry's. Shaving isn't fun. I don't care if you use an electric like I do most of the time, or if you use a blade like I've really been enjoying the Harry's. Either way, it's not fun. Sometimes you cut yourself, you scrape yourself with dull blades, and it's expensive. Razors run about $4 a blade. Some guy who like has a really heavy beard and maybe shaves every day, I know some guys shave a couple of times a day. Well, you're spending hundreds of dollars a year just on razors, like for instance the Gillette Fusion. Now, and when you go to the store to buy them, sometimes you think it's a, I don't know, you think you're cooking meth or something, because they keep them locked back in plexiglass cabinets. You almost have a prescription to get your blades. Well, Harry's is changing all that. Harry's gives us high-quality razors at about half the price of the big brand blades, and they make their own razors in their own factory in Germany. They engineer them for sharpness and high performance, and they ship them for free to your front door. And because they make and ship their own blades, it's a more efficient company, which means Harry's can give you and me and all of us factory direct shipping. And they guarantee your satisfaction. And in each kit, look at this. You get the razor. This is one of the razors right here. This particular color was their one for their limited edition over the holidays. But you get really nice. That's metal. They also have a plastic version. But it comes with this with three blades. And also the cover to go on the blade so that, you know, for your storage. And also a travel cover, which it's a, you know, throw this in your bag. You're not going to mess it up. And just a really nice travel cover to travel with, and shave gel. Good stuff. I like this shave gel. And I like a company that has a sense of humor. I noticed this morning, in fact, as I was getting my hairy shave this morning. The directions. Caution, don't put it in your eyes. Rinse if you do. And I swear to God, please don't eat it. It says right here. And also, they have lottery numbers. Now, of course, the joke's on you because number 18 is on here twice, but it has, there are, you probably can't see that, but there are lottery numbers on the on the back of the shave gel. So I love a company that has a sense of humor. And also, you know, they're a company called Harry's that helps you get rid of your facial hair. Their symbol is a woolly mammoth. Go figure. Love the sense of humor. Love the company. Love the price. Love everything about Harry's. They also have a really nice moisturizer aftershave that protects and hydrates your skin. And the price, you got to love it. About half the price of razors at the store, like your Gillette Fusion and all that stuff. It looks and feels quality because it is quality. Once you go to harrys.com, get $5 off your first purchase. Enter code HAMNATION. Now they are making those blades. Just a neat and there you go. See? Gordo's sporting the Harry's shave. And let me tell you something about that Harry's shave. My wife loves my Harry's shave. Oh, man. I come in there and I say, honey, I got my Harry's on. And she's like, ooh, let me feel. I'm not kidding. It's freaky. Go to harrys.com, enter code HAMNATION at checkout. All one word, HAMNATION. And you'll save $5 off your first purchase. Harry's, thank you so much for my clean, close Harry's shave. And you're going to love yours as well. And Gordo, he's a handsome cat and he owes it all to Harry's. George, did you get your Harry on?
I did, right? Don. I got it on last night.
All right. Well, there you go.
You know, you had that story in there a few moments ago about Radio Shack, and I'm sitting out in front of the old store here. By the way, you know, at Radio Shack, it's already 1970, according to the sign on the window here.
Wow, time flies.
Oh, it does. I just wanted to mention a couple of facts, you know, as long as we were on that, and you know, everything happened this week. It was founded in 1921, and just to put it in perspective, WLW didn't begin until March 22nd of 1922.
Been around a long time.
That's how long it's been around.
Wasn't Radio Shack actually founded by a bunch of extra class hams? I think I thought I read that somewhere. I know it was a bunch of hams. I think that actually got together and started the company. Or am I wrong about that? I think I read that somewhere.
It was a couple of brothers, and I don't think there were any kind of radio licenses back when that
maybe
started.
Maybe I just dreamt it all.
You probably did.
That's what I get for eating this shaving gel.
Yeah, you shouldn't be eating it, Don. That's probably why. Kind of like mushrooms, maybe. The first commercial radio station was KDKA. November the 2nd of 1920. So, you know, the Radio Shack started really about the time that broadcast radio started. They left the United Kingdom in 1999 and Australia in 2002, Canada in 2004. And on February 5th, this week, you know, or actually last week, right after Ham Nation, they filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection in the U.S., and after 11 consecutive quarterly losses. Now, you know, Chapter 11 is a restructuring one. And I've heard all kinds of theories and stories about, you know, what's really going to happen there. The one that I've heard most is that Sprint is buying up half the stores and, you know, the other half are being closed. And there'll be some kind of co-branded thing. Who knows, you know, until it happens. I really can't tell. But there's 4,297 U.S. stores, at least last week. And there's going to be 1,784 of them closed. And right now you can get some good deals on the stores that are closing. There's closeout sales going on there. The stores that aren't closing right now don't have sales. I made two trips up there this week and brought home some big hauls, got some really nice stuff at a really good price. Some of the stuff is not really discounted much, but some of it is just unbelievable. I bought a really nice digital ohm meter from them. It was maybe a couple of models ago, but they still had some in the store. I don't know what it sold for. New, probably, you know, more than $50. And I paid $2 and change for it. So
wow,
some really good, yeah, really good stuff there. And in addition to you know, the U.S. stores, there's 274 in Mexico, and 900 locations that are independent dealers, mostly in small towns. And there's no word on what's going to happen with those, but they probably won't be carrying Radio Shack merchandise, or we really don't know. You know, we'll just have to see. One other thing I want to mention is in a couple of weeks, February 28th, that's on a Saturday, I'm going to be speaking at the Hamfest in Orange, Texas. And if you're in the area, you know, drop on by. We're looking forward to the Hamfest there. I've never been to it before, but I understand it's a really growing Hamfest there, and it's in a super nice facility. So looking forward to that. And speaking of ham events, you know, Gordo, you were just at Course Fest here recently, and you were hanging out with Randy there, shooting some video, and we've got a little bit of that here.
Somebody has their APRS on the simplex frequency.
Well, good morning in the Course Fest area. This is Chris, KR1SS, welcoming you to Course Fest 2015.
Well, it looks ugly. It is ugly, but it's functional, and that's the ham motto, right? Who cares what it looks like as long as it works?
Oh, no, it's man, perfect. Look at this. Wow.
He hasn't nice seen Chinese those before. Solder.
Forgot to solder the hole.
So this is my mesh camera, so if any of you get on the mesh, here you'll see this camera. There's another one over at Maryland's rig over there.
Really light. It's 35 amp hour.
And what's that technology again?
Lithium iron phosphate. It's like yours, but this is 35 amp hours.
Not, I got this one for about 185.
Wow. My 7 cost me 200.
Not a whole lot more.
I know, I didn't want to tell you that.
Oh, man.
The IC9100 is perfect for this type of an environment because the screen is LCD black and white. We love the 7000 and the color screen, but the color screen out here in the bright sunlight at Quartz Fest is a little tough to read. So this is going to be our ideal W7Q special event station transceiver.
I got mine quite a long time ago when Anderson's first came out with them. So actually, my crimper actually is from Anderson Power Tools. So.
Oh wow.
Yeah, but it was quite expensive. Now they have the nice ones here. They're available online from a lot of different places and a lot of our ham radio stores. They're a lot less expensive.
So again, we twist the wire.
That's the backside go.
And we push it on to the point that the wire actually sticks on the end of the connection.
My name is Gary Heston, and my call sign is W6 Kilo Victor Charlie. And we're starting into digital. The system we have out here today is in the 70 centimeter band, and it is digital, and we're running about a watt and a half of digital on channel, actually cable channel 59, which is in the ham bands.
And Gordon was on the program, and he was demoing one of these SGC-230s. And I said, I've got to have one of those. And so at Dayton that next year, I bought a 230. And you can see it became almost a compassion with me playing with them.
The question everybody asks is, which tuner is best? Well, the answer is, it all depends what you're doing.
Good morning.
So happy to be at Quartz Fest and be with family and friends again. It's just going to be a great day. Ready?
Our morning exercise.
That's right. Wonderful wake-up exercise and get in shape for all the activities.
Morning, I'm Frank, KB7IQ. We're out here at Quartz Fest in January 2015, and we're getting ready for a four-wheel drive ride today, so we're going to go do a little bit of exploring in the desert of southwest Arizona here near Quartzsite. We're going up to the Plomosa Mountains, north and east of town here, where we're going to investigate some pretty good-sized four-wheel drive roads and a lot of neat exploring through some pretty mountainous area and several mines. We're even going to get to go into a nice mine tunnel today. We'll get to see a couple of vertical shafts that are quite deep. And lots of other great scenery. So it's going to be a beautiful day. And typical day in Arizona, the sun's out and everybody's happy.
All right, N4SVD here.
And we're at Quartz Fest 2015, and we're having a grand time. We got sunshine all the way to the ground, as you can see. And we got all this antenna walk around going around out here.
All right, everybody say the magic words. Up, periscope.
My name is Dan Hammer, KC8RL. We're full-time RVers. So we were looking for an antenna system that was easy to put up and easy to take down. The front antenna is my first antenna. It's my Walmart antenna. It has an auto tuner in the inside wall. It's loaded against the frame, and I used that for about 3 years. It will load up through 80 meters through 10 meters very, very successfully. The other one that I use and has probably somewhere from 2 to 4 S units better performance than the other antenna is the one on the roof.
Okay, now you didn't tell us the most important thing. What is it that makes that thing go up and down?
Okay, it's an elevation rotor. It's a little Yaesu satellite elevation rotor. The pipe goes all the way across the trailer. There's a rail on one side with the rotor. On the other side is a bearing. There's two stubs that go up, and that's what allows it to go up and down.
We had 4 kettles for the hobo stew, normal, medium, hot, and flamethrower. Rick W7RAP working on the Dutch oven cookout that people brought their ovens. Boy, did we eat good. This was fabulous.
Okay, here's a little faster song. Wake you up a little bit.
Saturday morning was the swap meet. People brought out their goodies.
25.
Yeah, we sold the oscilloscope.
But if you want to bring the radio by and try.
Lots of parts.
And if you hit the band switch twice, it'll change to the
Zenith radios, Heathkit scope, screwdrivers, tower. FT-101s, another Heathkit, microphones.
An accurate number that participated this year in Quartz Fest is 447. Totally, we had 23 take their exams. All of them passed, and I believe there's 12 new technicians.
And one extra.
Rick, how many did you have today? Well, the one that passed the technician passed in general today, so that's 25 who have, or 24 who have upgraded. And they've gotten their license upgraded.
Are we having fun yet?
Great video there, Randy. And Gordo, I swear, every time I see something else about Quartz Fest, it just keeps getting better and better, especially the sing-alongs.
Absolutely. Yeah, Russ and his sing-along Hootenanny group did a great job. Randy, outstanding. Back to you, George.
Okay. Well, it did look like a lot of fun. One of these years, I'm going to have to go to that. I did want to mention, you know, I talked a little bit a moment ago about that DV3000 digital board from Northwest Digital Radio that'll do D-Star and probably some other modes in the future. Mike, VE3MIC, and I have been working on that for the past couple of weeks. Got them going now. We're going to get on the D-Star net after the show tonight and try them out. And we'll be showing them this Friday, 7 p.m. at live.amateurlogic.tv. Central Time or 0100 UTC. So check that out. And it's really a nice little board. And it's only $100. So you might want to check into it. Well, you know, last week I asked a question and I showed an antenna. You know, we were setting up an HF station. I had some wire there and a ballon and all. And I told you what it was. I call it an off-center fed dipole. And my question was, what is another name for that antenna? And we've got a winner here is John Letney, AL5J. He says it's also known as an OCF or a Windham antenna. So congratulations, John. You're going to win this MFJ dual 24-hour clock. It's got one for local time and one for UTC. So you'll always know what time it is, no matter where you are. And for next week, we've got another question here. How did Joe Mesh test his handy talkie tonight? If you think you know the answer to that, send it to me at hamnationcontest@gmail.com. And you know what we're going to give away? Well, it's this Heil PR781G microphone right here. A really nice mic. I have never used one of these before, and until I decided, you know, I got to try this thing out before I give it away. So I'm impressed. Send your answer, hamnationcontest@gmail.com, and you might win it. Just tell me how Joe tested his handy talkie a little bit earlier. And now it's time to get Dale in here and see what we've got in the way of viewer videos this week. Hi, Dale.
Okay, George. Well, thanks a lot. We do have two videos tonight, a new Show Me Your Shack. We even have a couple of ugly shacks. And let's jump right in now to the current event stage and pick up a report from the third annual Puerto Rico State ARRL Convention with Angel Santana. He's WP3GW. Okay, well, thank you, Angel. Looks like a great place to visit during the middle of winter with 2 or 3 feet of snow all over the East Coast there. Unbelievable. But, well, another month has passed and we've received enough shack photos now to put together another episode of Show Me Your Shack. Let's watch now. This is Show Me Your Shack for early February 2015. Bob forwarded this image to me, but the original email was not attached, so I can't tell you this ham's call. But the picture was taken in January 1955. There's an NC-88, a Johnson Viking Adventurer built from a kit, and then the trusty J-38 key. David in Zero SAP in Ozark, Missouri, has a beautiful Drake station. Well, we see Mike, VE3MIC, in the chat room most weeks, and now we can see his shack. He says, when you're running short of space in the ham shack, go vertical. Now, here's a real ham shack photo. Roy, ZL1LK, has his shack in a kid's playhouse erected inside the garage. And here's a look at Roy's equipment. It looks like it just fits. Tom, K1TA, has been a ham for 40 years now. He says you can catch him on 20 or 40 meters. Most nights, he'll be on CW. And here's his rig. Don, K4YND, has a dedicated and very nice-looking heath kit operating position in his shack. Meanwhile, Mike, ZP5YW, sent us this greeting from his shack in Paraguay, Central America. He tries to always watch Ham Nation live and has been since the second show. This photo shows the antennas on one of his two towers. And this is Mike at his operating position inside the ham shack. We've had several requests for ugly shack photos, and several have volunteered. This shot comes from Rick. He's WU0S in Little Falls, Minnesota. Al, K1LTJ, a fellow 40-meter push show net control operator, sent us this photo. Al was streaming live during the net when Terry, KM4TC in Four Oaks, North Carolina, took this shot of his huge flat-screen monitor. Well, Bill, K1ATV, sent two photos. Here's a look at his amateur television antennas. The long one is his 70-centimeter transmitting antenna. The short antenna is his receiving antenna and down converter. It's operating at 1.2 gigahertz. Here's a look inside the shack. The down converter control box and the ID are superimposed on the video or on the desk. His camcorder has a built-in microphone, and he has a push-to-look microphone, which keys his transmitter. Wyatt, K0AVL in Topeka, Kansas, has his shack wedged into the corner of the laundry room. He has an ICOM IC7200, a ASU FT2900, and an ICOM F2821. He uses a 40-meter off-center-fed dipole along with a VHF-UHF Omni antenna. Well, Dan, WA5CYR, no longer has a car, but he didn't want to waste his beautiful Hustler resonators. He built this multi-band vertical, mounted it on the leg of his tower. He has resonators for 80 through 10 meters, but chose to use those for 40, 20, 17, and 10 meters in this installation. Well, Don, KB2YSI, sent this entry for the messy shack category. And if this workbench shot's not messy enough, he sent another. He uses an ICOM IC2000 along with a Radio Shack HTX252 and HTX202. His antenna's a J-pole. Ray, N0ZYX, sent us this photo of his shack in Sunrise Beach, Missouri. He lives near the Lake of the Ozarks. He's been off the air for more than 15 years, and he's just now starting to rebuild his shack.
The desk is made from four file cabinets and two solid core doors. His radio is an ICOM IC736. He uses it on all HF bands and 6 meters. He also has a 2 meter ICOM IC275H and a marine radio to monitor for mayday calls from the lake. And that's it for February. Make sure to send your shack photos to Ham Nation Videos at twit.tv. We'll get them into the next show, Me Your Shack. That episode will be sometime in early March.
And remember, Show Me Your Shack is all about your shack and your photos. So get them into us and we'll get you and your shack in the next episode. That address again, Ham Nation Videos at twit.tv. And don't forget to treat the XYL Saturday. It's Valentine's Day. To paraphrase a saying, if the XYL is happy, well, the ham is happy.
Mm-hmm.
Amanda's up next with the latest from the chat room. But first, let's check out the latest from ICOM.
From new models to classic radios, there's something for everyone this season. So get out or hunker down with ICOM. Celebrate ICOM's 50th year with the IC7850. Only 150 units are available, and each radio features 1.2 kHz optimized roofing filter, a new local oscillator design with improved phase noise, several spectrum scope enhancements, and distinct gold accents on the front panel and commemorative label. For contesters just starting out this year, ICOM's IC7600. You get advanced DSP technology and IF roofing filters, dual watch on the same band on an ultra-wide 5.8-inch display. Got cabin fever and need to get away? Get mobile with ICOM's IC2730A and ID5100A. The analog 2730A mobile and digital 5100A with built-in GPS. Both feature optional Bluetooth capability for hands-free operation, 50 watts output power on both VHF and UHF, and a large backlit screen. For entry-level D-Star operation, take the ID880H on the road. Features include a good menu structure and VHF-UHF dual-band functionality, one band at a time. To hunker down or get out, the ID51A Plus is a perfect radio to enjoy global communications. This dual bander has the free downloadable RSMS1A Android app, enhanced DV functionality, and additional D-Plus reflector link commands. Make sure you visit icomamerica.com/amateur for more information on ICOM's base stations, mobiles, and portables.
And you can tune in and enter to win after each episode of Ham Nation. Go to icomamerica.com/hamnation. Throw your name in the hat for some great swag prizes like T-shirts and hats. And go to icomamerica.com/hamnation for the official rules and check out all the previous drawing winners. For February, the grand prize is going to be that new ID51A+, the 5-watt dual-band, dual-watch, handy-talkie with D-Star, integrated GPS, automatic repeater list-up, and a lot more. A really nice radio. I've just ordered mine. And sign up and good luck. And don't forget to follow ICOM America on Facebook and Twitter. And now, I know we're running late, but let's get Amanda in here and see if we've got any quick chat room questions.
Well, good evening, George. I do have some questions. Oh, and happy Valentine's Day. Hey.
I love it.
Thank you. It reminds me of 3 years ago, I think, was our first appearance on Ham Nation, and I also wore some little heart antlers, so I had to keep up with the tradition there. Anyhow, you guys, happy Valentine's Day. Only ham radio operators have Cupid point out the radio that most suits them instead of their soulmate. So with that, I do have some questions, by the way, so let's get to it. And Gordo, thanks for sticking around, because I have a question specifically for you. So Steve, KE0ARB, would like to know, what should he use as a ratio for his balun on a wire dipole? Any suggestions what a good ratio is?
I do 1:1 if it's a regular dipole, but if it's off-center, the feed point impedance will increase as you go more off-center. Then I would use a 4:1 if it's a Wyndham or an off-center fed. But if it's a regular dipole, a 1:1 balun, or wind your own, as you saw a few issues ago, around your hand with coax right up at the feed point, and you've got it.
Thank you so much. Yeah, he said there's so many options. He just didn't know what to go with there. So there you go, Steve. I hope that answers your question for you. And then let's go to Mr. George. George, KB2MOB Rich would like to know, what recommendations do you have for a do-it-yourself QRP kit that fits into an Altoids container?
Oh, tough question. There are a lot of them out there. I'm trying to think of the one I built over here. It was a beacon, and boy, I can't remember. It was a couple of years ago I built it, and I just don't remember right now, but there are a lot of them out there. Just do some searching around for some QRP projects, and most of them will tell you if they'll fit an Altoids can, or they'll give you the measurements there. I wanted to make one point on the balun, which ratio you would want. What you're doing with the balun is you're matching the impedance of the output of the radio in your coax to the antenna. So typically 50 ohm coax, if you've got an antenna somewhere around 200 ohms, you're going to need 4-to-1 because that's the ratio between the two. So it really depends on the actual impedance of the antenna itself, and that'll help you figure out your ratio.
Very good. Thanks so much for the addition there, George, and yeah, for the do-it-yourself project as well. Good luck with that, by the way, Rich. You guys, I know I have some announcements to make. If we're short on time, I have to skip through them. I do want to announce some upgrades. N1 GEP Greg upgraded to General. We have K4 BTO upgraded to General, and Extra KD9CHO upgraded to Extra. You guys, congrats there.
Yay!
All right. Good job. And I've looked at some statistics. I said that right. From the ARRL, it looks like we're up 15% this year for upgrades and new licenses, I think, nationwide. So that's excellent news there, you guys. Keep it up. I think we have a good part of, play a good part of that, by the way. One more question. Don, are those beads from last year? Did you earn those beads or...
A gentleman never tells.
Oh.
Yeah, see? Oh. Yeah, well, no, Ray Novak and I know he asked that question because I saw it in the chat room. He and I went back and forth. I got these from Novak, and I could tell you about it, but I'm not sure, A.
Wow, that, I'm not sure.
I'm not sure that the statute of limitations has passed yet. But changing subjects, to talk about kits and stuff, if you're looking for something to put in an Altoids can, I'll tell you, the go-to guy is Joe Eisenberg, K0NEB. Right. He does the kit building forum at Dayton. He also does the kit building column in CQ Magazine. And if you don't subscribe to CQ Magazine, first off, what's wrong with it? I want you in the house. You ought to subscribe to CQ Magazine and support them. But look him up on QRZ and send him an email, K0NEB, K0 Nebraska. And Joe will hook you up with all the information you need about kit building. He is the de facto expert on kits, K0NEB, Joe Eisenberg. And he's probably in the chat room. He's in here quite often.
Very good. Well, thanks for the input there, you guys. Hey, that's all I've got tonight. Great show. Joe was so cool. Cool, very radio voice. So I enjoyed his segment very much. Back to you, Donna. I think you're closing up the show, you guys.
Yeah, we've had a good show tonight. A little bit long, but some really good stuff. And yeah, Dr. Joe Mesh, interesting stuff. And I think he's going to be on next week as well with some more stuff. So I am looking forward to that. What do we got to cover? Let's see. We want to talk about the wiki pages. We don't mention that nearly as often as we do. Anything you want to know about Ham Nation, go to the wiki. It's wiki.twit.tv/wiki/ham_nation, I believe is what it is. I don't see the entire link here, but Dan Van Evenhoven does the wiki, and it's just awesome. George, do you have the net frequencies for us?
Well, I know that 20 meters is going to be on 14.268. Echo link, star, do drop in, star, node number 355-800. And D-star, reflector 14, module C. And 40 meters, I'm not sure. Do you know that frequency, Gordo?
I'm tuning around, and...
somewhere around 7.278.
Yeah, around 7278, or up 10, down 10, and we'll try and find you.
Yeah, Dale, K0HYD, says 7278 in the chat room, so that's where it is. 7278 for 40.
Okay.
So there you go.
Yep. Don't forget on the D-Star Net, if you don't have a D-Star radio, you can listen to it at hamnationdstar.net.
Exactly. All right. Good stuff tonight, guys. Thanks a lot. Gordon, any final parting words for us tonight?
73. See you next week.
Perfect. All right, George, thank you for being here, and to Dr. Mesh and to Dr. Scove, Dr. T, for being part of the solar thing for us. She's doing that every week now, and man, we just love Tamitha Scove. Great job. And Amanda, great job as well. And Dale, good stuff with the Show Me Your Shack stuff. It's been a fun show, a full show, and we're going to do it again next week. Of course, it'll be after Mardi Gras. It'll be Ash Wednesday, so I won't have the beads, but that's all right. I'll have some of the memories, perhaps. So some of them. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. You know, and let me show the shirt. The Mardi Gras shirt. I got this specifically for the chat room because they always ask, you know, what I'm drinking. It's, you know, it's the Mardi Gras drinking team, you know, so for what that's worth. Exactly. Oh, my. Exactly. All right. So good night, everybody. Thank you for being here on Ham Nation. We do it for you. And if you weren't here, well, you know, we'd be off doing something else, probably drinking. So good night, 73. We'll see you next week.
73.